What do you think happens when you call one of the draw commands in OpenGL? Well, you won't be able to find the answer in the OpenGL specification simply because the API is high level by design and the vendors are free to implement it in whatever way they choose to. But if you dig into this, you will be able to find some information online. In general, the parameters of the draw call are stored in some sort of a buffer, along with various bits of the OpenGL state. At some point, the buffer is submitted to the GPU, which parses it and starts executing the commands inside it. So what's the problem? Well, the main issue with this model is that the OpenGL driver has no idea what we are actually doing on a higher level. It is only aware of the specific draw call that we are executing right now. But of course we know what we are doing, aren't we? We are building up a frame which is composed of a list of objects, and for each object we will execute a certain number of draw calls, while binding whatever number of vertex buffers and textures in between, and we will switch frame buffers to render into a textures and then use it, and well, the usual. But the driver is not aware of any of that, and therefore it is unable to optimize anything that requires knowledge of how the frame comes to life. This means that the main render function needs to repeat the exact same operations on every execution, when in fact the only thing that really changes is dynamic state, such as the orientation of the camera and things like that. Maybe not always, but this pattern is very common. If only there was a way to prepare most of the frame up front and save up most of the resources that the OpenGL driver requires. And this is where Vulkan comes in. It raises the buffers with the draw commands up to the API level and exposes them to the developer. We can now record as many command buffers as we want, within memory restrictions of course, before the game or the specific scene starts running. During runtime, we only need to submit the command buffers for execution, and Vulkan provides a mechanism for updating the uniform data. This allows the driver to optimize itself for a larger part of the frame, if not the entire frame, and dramatically reduces its overhead. But what if the use case requires us to record command buffers during runtime? Don't worry, Vulkan was designed from the ground up for multi-core CPUs, unlike OpenGL, which was born in the early 90s and is single-threaded by design. This means that we can record multiple command buffers in parallel on different threads and submit them on other threads. This enables the distribution of work across multiple CPU cores. And if that wasn't enough, then Vulkan also includes a set of synchronization primitives that provide fine-grained control over the execution order of different commands and improve the parallelism of the application. So before we jump into the details, let me just say a big thank you to Chris, Yun-Ha, and Emmerich, who recently joined the 3D Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/ogldev or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. The main object in this video is the Vulkan command buffer, which is used for storing draw commands, state changes, and etc. The command buffer handle is opaque in the sense that it represents the command buffer in the API function calls, but it doesn't expose the internals of the buffer. This means that we don't know the actual size of the buffer in bytes or the offset of the current command being recorded. This information is still privately managed by the driver. A command buffer must be allocated before it can be used, and this brings it into the initial state. When we decide to start filling the command buffer with instructions, we call begin command buffer, which brings it into the recording state. We can now use one or more functions with the prefix vkcmd to record commands into the buffer. When we finish recording all the commands, we call end command buffer to bring the buffer into the executable state. The command buffer is now ready to fulfill its purpose, and we can use it immediately or store it for later. During the execution of the frame, we submit the command into an execution queue. This changes the command buffer state to pending. Depending on various dependency conditions, as well as the current pressure on the GPU, the command buffer reaches one of the execution engines on the GPU and starts running. Once the command buffer is finished, it moves back to the executable state or becomes invalid if it was designated as a one-shot command buffer. This is the main life cycle of the command buffer, and as you can see in this diagram, there are a few other options and shortcuts, such as resetting or invalidating the command buffer. Since the command buffer can include multiple commands, and the user can also reset it back to the initial state and start recording all over again, we have to be careful not to cause memory fragmentation. For this, Vulkan provides the notion of a command buffer pool, which provides the memory that the command buffer needs. Now, this object is also opaque. We don't specify the size of the pool or the way it works, but we can think about it as an optimized memory allocator that reduces memory fragmentation by being tailored specifically for this job. In addition, the command buffer pool must be externally synchronized, which means that if you want to allocate, record, or reset command buffers in multiple threads, you have to explicitly synchronize the operation. An even better approach would be to allocate a pool for each thread, and this will allow us to safely record different command buffers in different threads in parallel, which is exactly what we cannot do in OpenGL. This is another example of how you can tailor the behavior of the application for the specific problem and the platform that you are using. In order to create a command buffer pool, we call create command pool, and in the corresponding create info structure, we have two main config attributes. First, we have the queue family index. So basically, each pool can be used to create command buffers only for the queues that belong to that specific family. If you plan to use multiple queue families, then obviously you will need to create a pool for each one. Next is the flags, which is a bit mask that can include zero or more of the following bits. The transient bit means that the command buffers will be short-lived. If you plan to allocate and deallocate command buffers very often, then you can consider using this bit. It will affect the way that the pool allocates memory. The reset command buffer bit means that you can reset a command buffer to the initial state and start recording it from scratch. If this bit is not set, then the command buffer is a write once buffer. Once it is recorded, you can only deallocate it. You can't reset it. And finally, starting with Vulkan 1.1, we have the protected bit. This allows the command buffer to access protected memory, which is an advanced topic, so we will skip it for now. Once the command buffer pool is created, we can start allocating command buffers using the function allocate command buffers. The main thing here is that you can create a command buffer which is primary or secondary. Primary command buffers can be submitted into a queue for execution, but you can't call them from other command buffers. And secondary buffers are exactly the opposite. You cannot submit them into a queue, but you can call them from other command buffers. This is the only way that they can actually be used. Now, why do we need this? This is a sort of a poor man's code reuse mechanism. You can store some common functionality in a secondary command buffer and then call it from multiple command buffers, which are of course primary. Again, not something that we will use at the beginning, but it's an important concept to be aware of. Okay, let's quickly go over the main code changes for this tutorial. And in this one, we also have changes on the application side. So we have a new project here, number 8. So let's start with the changes in the main application class. We have a couple of new private attributes. First, we have the number of images in the swap chain, and we have a vector of command buffers. We will need to create a command buffer for each image in the swap chain because everything is running in parallel. So while one image is being rendered, another is being created or recorded. So we need to separate the command buffers for the images. So in the init function, after the Vulkan core has been initialized, which is still a work in progress, right? We are still adding stuff there. We will get the number of images from the Vulkan core, store it in this new attribute, and then call create command buffers, which resizes this new vector for the command buffers handles. And we call a new function in the Vulkan core class called create command buffers, passing in the number of images, or in this case, the number of command buffers that we want to create, and the starting address of the vector, which I actually prefer to use the data function. It does the same, but I kind of like it better. Yeah. So basically, the Vulkan core class provides a service for creating command buffers. We're not calling any Vulkan core APIs functions here directly. Everything will be done here. So now let's jump over to the Vulkan core library or project, to the core CPP file. And in the init function, in order to create the command buffers, of course, we need a command buffer pool. So this is what we are actually creating here. We're not creating any command buffers, just the pool. Now, there's nothing new here because we've seen create command pool before. I'll just mention that you need to pass in the logical device as the first parameter. And right here we have the address of the create info structure. Right now I'm not using any flags here. We'll probably change in the future, but this is okay for now. We just need to put the queue family index, which we are storing as an attribute in the class. So this is okay. The function to create the command buffers is below. Okay, we're getting the number of command buffers and the address where the result will go to. So in the command buffer allocate info structure, we need to put the handle of the command buffer pool, which we got here and was stored as a new attribute in the class. Okay, so we put it here. Right now, all the command buffers will be primary. Again, we'll also change in the future, but this is okay for now. And the number of command buffers here, command buffer count. Okay, this is the parameter here. And then we call allocate command buffers, and we're getting those command buffers here. So now they can be used in the application. And this is it for today. The next video is going to be very exciting because we're going to record the clear command into these command buffers. So make sure to subscribe, hit the notification bell so you won't miss any episode. And thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one.